That was very loud. All right, and thank you for joining Hyliion's 2023 ACT Expo press conference. So this is a big show for us. The last time we did a press conference here at ACT Expo, it was the first time we were showcasing the Hypertruck ERX firsthand, live. It was the first time people getting to see it. This year, for the second time we're doing a press conference, it's the first time that anyone's getting to see the KARNO truck, the Hypertruck KARNO, up close in person, and then also get to see a little bit more about the KARNO technology. Before I dive in and share more about what KARNO is, how it works, we're going to give you a little bit of a technical overview as well. I just want to talk about the Hypertruck ERX. So for anyone who has gone for any ride and drives, hopefully you saw we have a couple of Hypertruck ERXs out back. And these vehicles are set up where they are fully electric drive vehicles, but then they have a natural gas generator under the hood that charges the batteries. So the Hypertruck ERX technology is going into production later this year. That's when we'll start the initial deliveries with fleets and having them run them in their operations under their own ownership. So it's a big year for us. If you haven't yet grabbed one, we got hats to celebrate the launch of the technology, but you know, this is a SOP year for us, start of production, and we couldn't be happier about it. So with that, there's been so much momentum recently around what's going on with CARB, with ACT, ACF. So a while back, maybe 6 months ago or so, we announced that the Hypertruck ERX was going to qualify for 75% of ACT credits. Fast forward to just last week, ACF finally went through its approval process and is now implemented, final language on it and everything. And we're thrilled to say that the Hypertruck ERX will qualify for 100% of ACF credits. So a huge win there as fleets are looking to actually comply with the ACF mandates. They can not only adopt a BEV solution, a fuel cell solution, but now they can also adopt the Hypertruck ERX and qualify for 100% credit. So major win for the team to push that through. And then as we look at what else is going on in Hyliion before we go to the KARNO, we recently just, and this is the first time we're announcing this as well, we received ISO 9001 certification. So 9001 is a quality procedure, right? Many of the OEMs, probably all of the OEMs in this room, have ISO 9001. We also recently received ISO 14001. And so we're proud of this because this is kind of Hyliion showing, look, yes, we are a young company, but we're doing the things that the industry expects, going and getting ISO certifications and getting ready for the start of production. All right, so now I'll transition into what we really showcased in today's show, which is the Hypertruck KARNO. So if I step back and kind of showcase the roadmap of Hyliion, so we're producing powertrains. As I mentioned, we have the Hypertruck ERX, which is a natural gas range extender. The vehicle behind me here today is the Hypertruck KARNO, which is a fuel agnostic range extender electric vehicle. And then we're also in development of the Hypertruck fuel cell, which, as the name shares, it's a hydrogen fuel cell powered vehicle. So what we've done is we've designed this range extender powertrain. We've got the e-axles, the battery packs, the fuel storage, but then we've designed it where we can replace the generator with different types of solutions. So to start, we have nat gas, then KARNO, then fuel cell. But all while doing that, we're able to keep the core technology of the powertrain the same. So that allows us to have this agnostic and flexible platform. So we keep the software the same, battery technology, e-axles, we carry all that forward. So this is really showcasing that, you know, over the years ahead, it is no longer going to be a one-size-fits-all solution of diesel fuel. We're going to have hydrogen, nat gas, propane, ammonia, like who knows what the solution is going to be in the years ahead. But the Hypertruck platform is designed to be able to utilize generators that can run on those various fuels. So now let's talk about the KARNO technology. And I'm going to, in a second here, have Josh join me to kind of give the technical deep dive on this. But you can see one of the linear generators sitting here in front of me. If you've seen the other side of this vehicle, you saw four of these linear generators on the side frame rail of the truck. So under the hood, you actually no longer have a generator. On this vehicle, we've mounted the genset on the side frame. And these four linear generators on the truck can produce about 200 kilowatts of power as they're running. So that means that generator's sitting there constantly just charging up the batteries as you're going down the road. Now, the other unique thing with this truck is, to my knowledge at least, this is the first truck that is truly a fuel-agnostic platform from the standpoint of we actually have both hydrogen storage tanks here as well as natural gas storage tanks here, and you can run these generators on both of those fuels, just hydrogen, just nat gas. You can switch it. The generator really doesn't care what fuel it's running on, unlike some of the other fuel-agnostic solutions where it's kind of like you have a platform that, you know, if you want to run it on hydrogen, you have to spec it this way. If you want to run it on nat gas, it's a little bit different. This generator can, from 1 second to the next, be switching what fuel it's actually running on. So what are the benefits what sets KARNO apart from others is a few things. So one is that fuel agnostic aspect. So while this vehicle, we have it equipped to run on two fuels, hydrogen and nat gas, there are actually over 20 fuels that this generator can run on. It can run on conventional fuels like diesel, gasoline. Can also run on gaseous fuels like hydrogen, propane, natural gas, obviously, as well as other solutions that probably aren't even really considered, like dimethyl ether or ammonia or things like that. So as we talk about, you know, there's not a one-size-fits-all solution going forward, the KARNO generator will allow fleets to be able to evolve with fuel as we're trying to figure out what the right fueling source is going to be over the years ahead. So number two is emissions, right? So obviously that's why we're doing this whole shift to electrification, is to reduce the emissions coming out of these vehicles, reduce emissions from transportation. So the KARNO has some fantastic characteristics that actually allow us to drastically reduce NOx emissions, but then also has the capability of running on fuels like hydrogen, which will have zero carbon emissions. And then lastly is efficiency. So the KARNO is capable of running at efficiencies close to about 60% indicated efficiency, which as you compare that against a conventional internal combustion engine, this is a huge step forward. You know, each percentage point, people usually spend hundreds of millions of dollars just to squeak small percentages forward in internal combustion engines. The KARNO generator, as where we are today, is already at about 60% indicated efficiency. There's also some other neat things, like when it's actually running, the sound of it is about, it's in the 60s in terms of decibels, like usually around 65. So that means if you're standing next to someone having a conversation with them, chances are their voice is actually louder than the KARNO generator running, producing 200 kilowatts. And then the other thing, which I'll let Josh explain more on, is there's no routine maintenance on this KARNO. There's no oil in it. There aren't parts that need to be replaced. It's really more of a philosophy where only fix it or only touch it when something breaks. So with that, I'll let Josh do a more of a technical overview.
Thanks, Thomas. Hello, everybody. My name is Josh Mook, and I'm the chief engineer responsible for the KARNO system development. And I want to share with everybody today a little bit, kind of pick up where Thomas left off and talk about, well, how does it work, right? It's great to see parts on the table as well as systems on the truck, but kind of let's get a little bit deeper. And so I think Thomas, you know, he talked quite a bit about the ability to run on many fuels, but why is that so? And the main reason is because the way this system differs from most traditional systems that you're used to is this is a heat engine. Its actual input to the system is heat. It just so happens that one of those convenient ways to create heat, especially onboard a vehicle, is to take fuels and oxidize those to release those chemical bonds and create that heat. So what you see here on the table, and afterwards, hopefully everybody who hasn't had a chance to come see it can come see it, this represents almost the entire heat engine as it's shown on the truck. And so what we do is we react a fuel through an oxidation process, create that heat, bring it in through these complex heat exchangers that you see on the ends here, which can capture upwards of 95, if not more, percentage of that heat and put it into the cycle. The entire engine from that point on is a sealed vessel, so that's why it requires no maintenance, no oil. It's completely orientation agnostic, meaning if I want to tilt it on its side or lay it down, it's fine to do so with no planned maintenance activities. Once that heat, we capture it through this system, we bring it in to the cylinder that expands this trapped gas. that trapped gas will then move a piston. But as that piston translates inside, there are actually permanent magnets that are going through a series of coils to create that electricity directly. So unlike what you may be used to in, let's say, an internal combustion engine, where you have, you know, the engine is breathing air to the outside, you have oil systems, you have rotary motion that needs to be transferred into electrical, that's all essentially eliminated. It's just straight linear motion creates the electricity directly. We then take that electricity and put it onto the bus of the vehicle, for which we can use it for the traction drives or recharging the electric motor. After we generate that electricity, the piston has moved to one side, the piston and shaft combination, in which case there's an equal and opposite thermodynamic cycle running on the other side, which has an opposite force that pushes it back in the other direction. And then what you'll notice is this sort of oscillates back and forth up to about 20 hertz or so, depending on the operating condition. So really interesting technology, very quiet. It doesn't breathe to the outside world. There's no explosions occurring. There's very low emissions, as Thomas mentioned, very low durability, maintenance items as a result. The other thing that you'll notice here, and I encourage you to explore the booth on these items, is some of the advanced design and manufacturing technology that we're leveraging to achieve these sort of efficiencies. So we're leveraging a lot of additive manufacturing or 3D printing to get these very complex shapes, yet without very many failure modes that would ultimately result in durability challenges. And so again, I'll encourage everyone to look at these parts. I've got some samples here and sitting all around the booth where you can see these very complex heat exchangers, as well as other mechanical systems that are made through these advanced manufacturing technologies. Finally, the way that you should think about this is each shaft, as you see it sitting here, is good for about 50 kilowatts onto that DC bus. And then you simply deploy as many or as few of those as you need to achieve the power demands of your application. So in this particular, the Hypertruck KARNO here behind us, we needed 200 kilowatts to satisfy its mission, hence why you see four of these deployed on that system. If you have a heavy haul application or maybe a lighter application, we can very easily scale up or down those systems to suit. And so hopefully that's a good introduction to the general concept of it. So I think with that, I'll hand it back over to Thomas to finish us up.
Thanks, Josh. So as you heard from Josh and as before, I mean, this is really a truly fuel agnostic platform, one that's offering efficiencies that are far exceeding what the industry is used to, and then also offering significant reductions in emissions. So we obviously see this as a great solution to be utilized onboard the vehicle to charge these batteries as the truck's going down the road. We see it being a huge win for the trucking industry. But I also want to talk about what other applications does the KARNO have. So if any of you have looked at adopting BEV solutions, which I'm guessing most of you have if you're at this conference, you know that probably the thing that's even more difficult than finding a BEV to buy is trying to find a place where you actually have enough electricity to deploy a charger to actually power up that truck. So with that, one of our plans with the KARNO is we're actually going to be looking to deploy this into stationary applications as well. So we not only see this as a genset to go on the truck, but also one that can be deployed next to an EV charger, one that could go out behind a hotel, behind a warehouse that consumes a lot of electricity, maybe at a data center. And you can actually produce your own electricity locally and kind of flip the normal way you think about the grid on its head. So if you think about, like, let's take a grocery store. They use the grid to power the store, run the refrigerator, everything like that. And almost every grocery store, most grocery stores, have a generator out back that's there and ready to be kicked on if the power goes out, because they don't want to have everything that's refrigerated go bad. Well, now with the KARNO, because this generator likes running 24/7, right? Josh talked about the inherent low maintenance or no maintenance that this system requires. So if you own one of these, you want to run it. So that means what you're best off doing is actually flipping the model to using the KARNO as your primary power source for a grocery store, and then actually thinking about the grid as your backup electricity for if there was a problem with the KARNO. And then all while doing that, if we think about kind of normal costs, and we'll use natural gas here, we're looking at being able to produce electricity out of the KARNO at about 7 cents per kilowatt hour. Now, to put that into comparison, I was just chatting with someone who runs a foundry up in Rhode Island. They just locked in a one-year rate of 29 cents per kilowatt hour. Obviously, that's a very high number, but that's what we're seeing with the electric grid. So we're going to be utilizing in trucks. We'll also be looking to deploy these in stationary applications and hopefully help some of you with your BEV adoptions as well. Thank you very much.